الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده على من لا نبي بعده ولا أمة بعد أمته ولا كتاب بعد كتابه ولا شريعة بعد شريعته أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام را كتاب أنزلناه إليك لتخرج الناس من الظلمات إلى النور صدق الله العظيم My dear respected elders and brothers The ayat recited Allah Azza wa Jal has made mention with regard to one of the beauties of the Holy Quran and we have just emerged fresh from the month of Ramadan and we are all aware that the month of Ramadan is also known as the month of the Quran because it was in the month of Ramadan that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed the Holy Quran so therefore in today's bayan and perhaps in the next bayan or so would like to make mention of the beauty of the Holy Quran and the rights and the duties that we owe to the Holy Quran The Holy Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unique in every one of its aspects. Not only in the grandeur of its literary style and the splendor of its words, but also in its substance, meaning and message. There has been no other book, sacred or otherwise, which has had such a vast and deep impact upon the history of mankind. No other kitab which has so radically changed the individual and the collective life of millions of people the way the Holy Quran has. The Holy Quran is unique, as I said, in every one of its aspects. There is no other kitab which has made mention with regard to transforming the life of people the way the Holy Quran has. It is far more superior than the sermon of anyone who gives sermons or any other preacher. The ethical and moral teachings of the Holy Quran are a class on its own. It is a kitab which the way it reveals the strength and the weaknesses of the human being, it is nothing but astounding. The way the Quran makes mention of the weakness of the human being and how it makes mention of the strength of the human being, it is astounding. See at how Allah Ta'ala makes mention in Surah Waqi, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ خُلِقَ هَلُوعًا Allah Ta'ala has created human being, he is prone towards hastiness. He likes to do things in haste without giving proper thought to the consequences of his amal. At times Allah Ta'ala makes mention with regard to the strength of human beings in such a manner that if you just read through it casually, you won't even understand that how Allah Ta'ala has made mention with regard to the strength of human beings. Says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the second chapter of the Holy Quran, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ كَانَ ظَلُومًا جَهُولًا That human being is ignorant. Now, how do you say that this is the strength of a human being? You cannot say this mic in front of you is ignorant because it does not have the capacity to understand and receive. Therefore, you will not say a mic that it is ignorant. By making mention with regard to human being ignorant, Allah Ta'ala has also revealed that yes, there is a plus point and a positive aspect with regard to this, that he has the capacity to understand. He has the capacity for intellect. Therefore, the opposite is also true of himself. It is such a kitab. It is such a kitab that no contradictions or no falsehood can find a way through the Holy Quran. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ Says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Nisa, Don't you ponder over the Holy Quran. وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا Had it been from anyone else besides Allah, you would have found many contradictions. But because it is from Allah, there is no apparent contradiction in it. There is no contradiction in the Holy Quran. The Quran is such a kitab that it reveals the life and reveals with regard to the previous ummah. But yet it cannot be described as a book of history. Because when it makes mention of those previous ummah, it is not to give you historical information, but to give you a moral lesson. لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِعُلِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Verily in all the incidents we have made mention of in the Holy Quran, there is ibrat and there is lessons for those who possess understanding and intellect. It throws light on a variety of sciences, yet you cannot call it a textbook of science. It is not poetry, despite its very beautiful rhythm and eloquence, and despite its captivating charm and attractiveness. Allah Ta'ala says in the Holy Quran, وَمَا هُوَ بِقَوْلِ الشَّاعِرِ. It is not the word of any poet. It is something which is beyond poetry. Then what is the Holy Quran? In the ayat which I have recited before you, Allah Ta'ala has made mention with regard to the greatest aim and objective of the Holy Quran. That it has been revealed by Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, for whom all praise is due, for granting us such a great kitab, to guide mankind upon the right path. Kitabun anzalnahu. It is a kitab that we have revealed. لِتُخْرِجَ النَّاسِ. To remove people and humanity. مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ. From darkness. From the darkness of kufr. From the darkness of ignorance. From the darkness of transgression. From the darkness of superstition. مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ. And bring them upon the light. The light of iman. The light of ilm. The light of iman and conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a kitab which makes mention of the common source of all religions. كَانَ النَّاسِ أُمَّةَ وَاحِدَةً. The entire humanity were upon one religion. One religion from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it confirms and affirms all what has been revealed upon the previous Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. We find many a times made mention of in the Holy Quran. It confirms what has been revealed upon you, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what has been revealed upon the previous Anbiya alayhimu salatu wasalam. It is such a kitab and such a book that does not need any introduction, because it introduces itself. Ask of the Holy Quran with regard to its origin. The Holy Quran will call out, تَنْزِيلٌ مِّن رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. I have been revealed from the Lord of the worlds. تَنْزِيلٌ مِّن حَكِيمٍ حَمِيدٍ. I have been revealed and I come from one who is full of praise and full of wisdom. And then where it is, its source, where does it come from? The Quran will call out, بَلْ هُوَ قُرْآنٌ مَّجِيدٌ فِي لَوْحٍ مَّحْفُوظٍ. The source of the Holy Quran is from the protected tablet in Jannah and in the heavens. And then ask of the Holy Quran that how did you make your way through to the world, to this material world? And the Quran will say, نَزَلَ بِهِ الرُّوحُ الْأَمِينُ. I came through the means and the agency of Ruhi Amin, Hazrat Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. Upon who did you come in this world? نُزِّلَ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَهُوَ الْحَقِّ. 26th part of the Holy Quran. I have been revealed upon Hazrat Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and I am the truth. And then when did it come? The Quran will say, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. It is a month of Ramadan that the Holy Quran was revealed. In which night did you come? إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ. We revealed the Holy Quran in the night of Qadr. And look at the beauty of the Holy Quran. The night in which it was revealed is the most superior night throughout the entire year. The month in which it was revealed, it is شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ, the greatest of all the months of which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has established. The Prophet upon whom it was revealed is Imamul Anbiya, the greatest and the Imam of all the Prophets. The Ummah upon which it came upon was Khayre Ummah, the best of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Ummah. The period in which it was revealed is Khayrul Qurun, the best of all times. This is the Holy Quran, my dear respected brothers. And the Holy Quran is a miracle. It is a miracle in more ways than one. It is a miracle of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There were many miracles of our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Quran enjoys a distinction not only amongst the miracles of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but also amongst the miracles of all the former prophets. The reason being that all the miracles that came with the former prophets, upon their passing away, that miracle ceased to exist. The asa of the Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, the staff of the Musa alayhi salam, is well known. That when you used to throw it down, it used to turn into a snake. But with the passing away of the Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, if anyone were to touch that staff, it would not produce that same miracle, because it was confined to the time of the Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. But because the Quran is the miracle of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasalam, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasalam's miracle and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam's prophethood will be till the day of Qiyamah. The miracle Allah Ta'ala had granted him also will remain till the day of Qiyamah. And the Quran, as I've made mention, is a miracle in more ways than one. The ulama have made mention that one of the miracles of the Holy Quran is the mode of expression, the richness of the expression of the Holy Quran. The first recipients of the Holy Quran were the Arabs, whom we refer to as the ignorant Arabs, those who were in the time of Jahiliyyah. They did not have any pretension to ilm, knowledge and wisdom, but yet they favored themselves with one aspect, and that was with regard to the mastery they had over the Arabic language. They had a complete mastery over the language, and they had such a mastery that they were in possession of a spontaneous eloquence, an eloquence that even upon the spur of the moment, an ordinary Arab of that time would reel off hundreds of poems. They were such poets in pre-Islamic times that when they used to refer to a particular thing with one word, they never again in their poetry referred to that same item with the same word. They always used another word. They had a complete mastery over the Arabic language. Therefore, they used to, due to this mastery, refer to non-Arabs as ajam, people who are dumb, people who can't speak. Why they can't speak? Because they had such a mastery over their language. But yet when the Quran came on the scene, and when the Quran was revealed upon Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Quran laid down a challenge to humanity. وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا. If you are in any doubt over what we have revealed upon our bondsman, فَاتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ. Then bring one surah equivalent to the beauty of the Holy Quran. Despite the mastery the Arabs of that time had over the Arabic language, despite the fact that they were extremely hostile to our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and given half a chance, they would not have hesitated to hurt or embarrass our beloved Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But despite that, they could not raise up to this challenge. In fact, they were completely taken aback by the challenge. Walid bin Mughira was one of the greatest poets of that time. And one day he came to the gathering of the Quraysh of Makkah. And he told the Quraysh of Makkah, and they were discussing, how do we put a stop to the strength and to the spread of Islam? Walid bin Mughira said, leave it to me, let me go and approach Muhammad. I will put forward to him various baits. And he came to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he told Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that if you seek wealth through the means of prophethood, we are prepared to make available all the wealth of Makkah to you. If you seek leadership, we are prepared to make you the king. If you seek any women through the means of prophethood, we are prepared to make your nikah to any women of Arabia. You just have to make the choice. Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not say anything at that stage. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited the few opening rukus of Surah Hamim Sijda. It had such an effect upon him that he just stood there forgetting the reason and objective why he had came. And he stood befixed and bewitched with what Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was reciting, because he knew Arabic. He realized that this was something which is beyond the scope and the ability of a human being. And when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after a few rukus, made sijda of Hamim sijda, he also fell down into sijda. And when he came back to the Quraysh of Makkah, they all started saying that it seems that Walid bin Mughira has also left his religion. He has also gone. We have sent him to stop the spread of Islam. It seems that he has also been taken aback. And then Walid bin Mughira came and he said, oh people of Makkah, leave Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alone. His religion is going to spread. You call him a poet, but yet I have known and I'm aware and have knowledge of all the poetry of the people of Makkah and Arabia. This is something which is beyond poetry. You, Aliyadu Billah, refer to him as a madman. When people hear him saying such beautiful things, they will never believe that he is a madman. And the only thing that I can say is that perhaps you could call him a sorcerer, one who distinguishes and differentiates and creates rift between parents and their children, between brothers and brothers, and between people of the same tribe. The Quran says, and then despite the people of Arabia, there is something else. But even up till today, the literature of Arabia, of the Arabic language, both classical and modern, is even up to today. And yet they could not raise and meet up to this challenge of the Quran. The Quran has made mention, قُلْ لَئِنِ اجْتَمَعَتِ الْإِنْسِ وَالْجِنِّ أَلَا أَيَعْتُوا بِمِثْلِ هَذَا الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَعْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ. If all the jinnat and all humanity gather together and they would like to bring an equivalent to the Holy Quran, لَا يَعْتُونَ بِمِثْلِهِ, they will never be able to do so. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, and if you cannot do so, وَلَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, and you will never be able to do so. فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ, then fear the fire of Jahannam. The fuel of that fire is الحجارة, mankind, and stones. This is one aspect of the beauty of the Holy Quran. Another aspect of the miracle of the Holy Quran is with regard to the authenticity of the Holy Quran. There are many other revealed books and many books that came upon the past prophets, but they are not today in its original and authentic form. But yet today we can say with pride that the Quran that we read, without even the change of a single word or even a change of a single dot, it is a very holy Quran, the very same words we read that was revealed upon our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah Ta'ala has preserved it not only in the shape of its words, but also in the hearts of human beings. That if today someone were to try and erase and eradicate the Holy Quran from the pages and the words of the Holy Quran, they will not be able to erase and eradicate it from the protected vault which carry the Holy Quran. And that protected vault are the hearts of the Huffaz Ikram, which contain the Holy Quran and the words of the Holy Quran. And in this, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fadl, and we got is Allah ta'ala's grace, that the Huffaz who protect the words of the Holy Quran and the ulama who protect the meanings of the Holy Quran, they are in reality a manifestation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's miracle made mention in the first ruku of the 14th supara, Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikr wa inna lahu lahafizun. Verily we have revealed the Holy Quran, the reminder, wa inna lahu lahafizun, and we will see to its protection. Only two aspects of the miracle of the Quran I have made mention. Inshallah, in the future weeks, we will make mention of other aspects of the Quran's beauty, and also with regard to the rights and duties that we owe to the Holy Quran. May Allah Ta'ala give you another tawfiq. As Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam taught us the hadith, the dua, Allahumma zayyin akhlaqana bil Quran. Oh Allah, adorn our character with the Holy Quran. Allahumma nawwir qulubana bil Quran. Oh Allah, enlighten our hearts with the Holy Quran. Wa najjina minan nari bil Quran. Save us from the fire of Jahannam through the means of the Quran. Wa adkhilna al jannata bil Quran. And enter us into Jannah through the means of the Holy Quran. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillah.
أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قتل ما أوحي إليك من الكتاب وأقم الصلاة وقال تعالى كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته صدق الله العظيم.
My dear respected elders and brothers, in last week's bayan, we made mention of certain aspects of the beauty of the Holy Quran. And on that occasion, we had said that inshallah, in our future bayans, we will look at other aspects relating to the Holy Quran. Today, I would like to make mention of the duties and the rights that we owe to the Holy Quran. The ulama have written that each and every Muslim is related to the Holy Quran in three ways. Or he should be related to the Holy Quran in three ways. The first of that is recitation of the Holy Quran. And in this recitation, with or without understanding the meaning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Utlu ma uhiya ilayk." Make tilawat. We all understand tilawat to make recitation of the Holy Quran. Utlu, recite what has been revealed upon Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala narrates that Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had said, Man qara'a harfan min kitabillah falahu bihi ashratu amthaliha. Aw kama qal. Whoever reads one word of the Holy Quran. Here again, what is the word, the Arabic word? Qara'a. He who reads one word of the Holy Quran, for him will be rewarded he will be rewarded for each letter tenfold, 10 rewards upon each and every word. Then Nabi Karim Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam further explained and said, I do not say that if you recite Alif Lam Mim, Alif Lam Mim does not constitute one word. But in Alif Lam Mim, Alif constitutes one word, Lam constitutes a separate word, and Mim constitutes a separate word. So in reciting Alif Lam Mim, a person will gain 30 rewards from Allah Azza wa Jal. And the word again of the hadith, Man Qara'a, he who recites and reads. You can imagine, there are 6,666 verses of the Holy Quran. How many letters and words there must be? If a person recites and completes one recitation of the Holy Quran, how much reward he becomes entitled to receive from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then furthermore, we must not misunderstand or mistake the Quran as an ordinary book of any mortal. The Quran is kitab of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And any other book authored by someone else besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a person can say that it would be meaningless to recite it without understanding it. But this is kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not only kitab of Allah, it is not only the book of Allah, but it is a speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the inseparable quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the speech which emanated directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, if a person recites the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he becomes closer towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in a hadith which appears in Ibn Majah, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, Allahu ashaddu udhunan ila qari'il Qur'an. Allah ta'ala re-listens more eagerly to the person who recites the Qur'an, qari'il Qur'an, one who recites the Qur'an, than what a master will listen to the singing of his slave girl. We know that music is something which attracts many people, which many a times people become addicted towards it. The hadith makes mention of it as a matter of fact, not to justify it, that there are many people who become excessively addicted to the music, and they feel that they gain great amount of joy in listening to that music. This hadith makes mention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala listens more eagerly and listens to music when he is addicted, possesses a slave girl and who has an attractive voice. The way she or he will listen to that slave girl listening to that music, Allah ta'ala even listens to the reader of the Holy Quran more eagerly also. Hazrat Abu Zar Ghaffari radiallahu ta'ala anhu once asked Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for advice. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him several advices. Amongst one of them was, عَلَيْكَ بِتِلَاوَةِ الْقُرْآنِ فَإِنَّهُ نُورٌ لَكَ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَذُخْرٌ لَكَ فِي الْآخِرَةِ أَوْ كَمَا قَالَ. O Abu Zar, stick to that tilawat of the Qur'an, recitation of the Holy Qur'an, for it is nur for you in this world, and it will be provision for you in the year after. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one hadith also reads, إِنَّ هَذِهِ الْقُلُوبَ تَصْدَعُ كَمَا يَصْدَعُ الْحَدِيدِ إِذَا أَصَابَهُ الْمَاءِ قَاقِيلَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَمَا جِلَاؤُهَا. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this heart of yours also get rusted the way iron get rusted when water comes over iron. That the heart, due to negligence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to guna, they get spiritually rusted the way iron get rusted when water comes upon it. So the sahaba asked, وَمَا جِلَاؤُهَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. How will we then cleanse it, O Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, كَثْرَةُ ذِكْرِ الْمَوْتِ وَتِلَاوَةُ الْقُرْآنِ. Frequent remembrance of death and tilawat of the Holy Quran, recitation of the Holy Quran. So therefore, respected brothers, don't let anyone ever fool you that there is no benefit in reading the Holy Quran without understanding it. There is definitely great spiritual benefit, and we should endeavor. And one of the rights that we have towards the Holy Quran is to recite and make tilawat of the Holy Quran as frequently as possible. As frequently as possible. The hadith also makes mention that the houses in which the Quran is recited, they shine for the dwellers of the heaven the way the stars shine for the people who are on the earth. The way we see the stars shining towards the heaven, similarly, the houses in which Quran is recited, it it shines towards the dwellers of the heaven. They look at it as stars from the heaven onwards. So that is something which is important. But of course, we should not then remain contented with that. That is the first right that we owe to the Holy Quran. The second right that we owe to the Holy Quran is to make an earnest effort to understand the Holy Quran. Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, Kitabun anzalnahu ilayka mubarakun liyadabbaru ayati. A kitab that we have revealed unto you, which is very blessed. Liyadabbaru ayati, that you must ponder over those ayat. Now, one of the popular misconceptions is that the ulama discourage people from understanding the Holy Quran. Aliyadu billah, hasha wa kalla. What right do the ulama have in discouraging people from understanding the Holy Quran? Yes, what the ulama do make mention of is, make a proper understanding of the Holy Quran. Understand the Quran properly. Because the Quran is the speech of Allah Azza wa Jal. And tafsir is the interpretation and the explanation of that speech. So when a person asserts that this is what is the meaning of this ayat, or this is the interpretation of this word or this verse, he purports that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means this. So in this way, his comprehension, his understanding is attributed directly to Allah Azza wa Jal. In this way, ambiguity or carelessness or giving an opinion with regard to the ayat of the Holy Quran without knowing the relevant sciences, without any proper knowledge, or on pure whim and fancy of a person, that could lead to slandering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the one of the gravest violations of the Sharia and the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ افْتَرَى عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ. Who can be more unjust than he who falsely attributes something towards Allah Azza wa Jal? Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Nahl, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبِ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ. Do not set forth with your tongue anything false and saying, هَذَا حَلَالٌ, this is halal, هَذَا حَرَامٌ, this is haram, falsely attributing it towards Allah. For verily, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ, he who falsely attributes anything towards Allah, لَا يُفْلِحُونَ, he will never gain success and he will never achieve prosperity. Therefore we find the Sahaba Ikram and our pious predecessors were very cautious with regard to interpreting any verse of the Holy Quran. Imam Jalaluddin Suyuti rahmatullah alayh, in his monumental book Al-Itqan fi Ulum al-Quran, Itqan with regard to the Ulum and the knowledge of the Holy Quran, is written on the authority of Abdul Rahman ibn Sulaym rahmatullah alayh, that the Sahaba Ikram Ridwanullahi ta'ala and Mujma'in would learn 10 ayats of the Holy Quran, and they would not thereafter proceed until they have comprehended all the literary and the practical aspects of the 10 ayats. Only after understanding the 10 ayats, make practicing upon it, then they would proceed to the next 10 ayats. Now they were people who used to speak Arabic, but yet they found it necessary to have a proper understanding of those ayats which they have recited from our beloved Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu was once asked a matter to give an opinion with regard to an ayat of the Holy Quran. He replied, and listen to his reply carefully, he said, which earth will bear me and which sky and heaven will give me cover if I venture to give opinions of the Holy Quran without having proper knowledge about it? Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he is among the most knowledgeable of all the ashab, one who had the most knowledge. And as far as knowledge, as far as taqwa, as far as piety, purity, wisdom, spiritual insight is concerned, he held a very, very lofty rank. Yet this was his caution with regard to the Holy Quran. Our condition today is, if a person just knows a few sentences in Arabic, or he has just glanced through few Islamic publications, he now regards himself as an expert to render interpretation and to give tafsir of the Holy Quran. He wants now give tafsir, not only tafsir, he will even go to further an extent of taking out the so-called mistakes of the pious ulama and the predecessors of the mufassirin of the past. And yet we know, with regard to secular sciences and arts, it is common knowledge that merely understanding English or merely understanding the language, merely understanding English and thereafter reading through a medical textbook or reading through a manual of law does not make one qualified to dispense with medicine or does not make one qualified to practice as an attorney. It is common knowledge, everyone knows that there are stringent conditions which apply before a person can dispense with medicine or he'll be allowed to practice as a lawyer or as an attorney. This is common knowledge. Similarly, there are also stringent conditions that apply before a person can comment or interpret or deduce commands from the Holy Quran. Against this, the normal argument that is presented is there is no priesthood in Islam. There is no monopoly of any group upon the Holy Quran. Each and everyone has equal access to the Holy Quran. Very, very true. Each and every Muslim has access to the Holy Quran. There is no money or monopoly of any group over the Holy Quran. But it is a qualified right. Just as we say in a democratic society or in a democratic system, not that I'm extolling the virtue of that particular system, but just making mention as an example, we say every citizen has the right, the qualified right to become the prime minister or the president of the country. But if a taxi driver comes and says, now, I have that right, I must become the prime minister, he will be told in no uncertain terms that yet you have the right, go and attain the necessary skills and qualification and come through the normal channels, then you can become the prime minister of the country if you so wish. Similarly, with regard to the Holy Quran, we must understand, when we say that everyone has equal access to the Holy Quran, it does not mean even for a moment that everyone, even if he does not have any knowledge whatsoever, can go and interpret the Holy Quran or interpret an ayat of the Holy Quran, no matter how far-fetched or absurd that interpretation might be. You see, in Pakistan, there have been many jokers who have ruled Pakistan. Among them, there was one who used to have the policy of nationalizing the industries. And they used to have people who used to support them. So one such prime minister of Pakistan in the past, used the ayat, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقْتَهُ أَيْدِيَهُمَا, which deals with the punishment of the one who steals, used that as a criteria for nationalizing the industries in Pakistan. Now, will we accept that? No, everyone has equal access to the Quran, so therefore accept his interpretation. The Quran will become a joke like that. No, what it means when we say each and everyone has equal access to the Holy Quran is this. Unlike other isms, other ideologies, and other religions, where a person had to belong to a particular family or a particular grace group, then only he could study that religion, Islam is not like that. The Quran is open for everyone to go and study. Go and acquire the knowledge of the Holy Quran. And after you acquire the knowledge of the Holy Quran, you then come and venture and give an opinion. It does not mean that you can now give an opinion without knowing the relevant sciences of the Holy Quran. It is open to anyone. Anyone can go and learn it. And then after learning, he can come and give and venture an opinion and interpret the Holy Quran. But he has to go through the relevant sciences. There are various sciences which the ulama have written. I don't want to go into the detail. I'll give you an example. A person perhaps, the ulama have written 15 branches of knowledge a person will have to know before he can then interpret the Holy Quran. Amongst that is Arabic language, knowing the grammar of the Arabic language, sentences and word formations, knowing which ayat preceded another ayat in Revelation. Recently, or some time back, I read a publication from UK, a newspaper, where they had a feature on Islam. They interviewed one particular Arab who was seen in a bar. He was drinking and he was taking to alcohol and intoxicants. They asked him, doesn't your religion forbid it? He said, yes, my religion only says, لا تقربوا الصلاة وأنتم سكارى. Don't come near Salat in the intoxicated state. So it said, don't drink. You can drink, but as long as you don't drink when you go for Salat. And the time of Salat, you must not be in an intoxicated state. He didn't understand that there was a riot that came thereafter which cancelled that particular ayat. If a person does not know all that, he does not know which ayat preceded another ayat in Revelation, he will not be able to understand and grasp the purport of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, I have revealed the Quran, O Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon you, that you might explain explain it to people, لتبين للناس, to explain what has been revealed to you. The sayings of Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a commentary of the Holy Quran. How do you understand the Quran without knowing the commentary of the Holy Quran? The Quran says, Aqimus Salah, perform Salat. How are you going to determine how you're going to perform Salat without going back to what Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam had said? So this is what I made mention. We must understand it very clearly. Some people get away by saying no priesthood in Islam, therefore everyone has got the right to interpret it the way he wants. It is completely a false notion. And even more surprising is not only those who interpret it, but with regard to the common people whom we accept as people whom interpret the Holy Quran. Jaan ke maamle mein hum itne fayaz nahi hai. We are not so generous in matters of our physical self and in matters with regard to our wealth. If anyone has a sickness, he will go to the best doctor and the best specialist to gain a treatment with regard to his sickness. And if he wants to invest his money, he will make 100 investigations before who he may investigate or invest his money with. A credible organization it must be. And if there is just the slightest rumor with regard to that organization and with regard to that investment, then you will see the queue in that investment company trying to pull out their money. That is with regard to our physical self and with regard to our wealth. But Iman we regard as so cheap. Iman we have regarded as so cheap that we will take Iman from anyone. We will take our deen from anyone. If a person comes on the radio, he can't even read the passage of the ayat of the Quran. If you put a class 3 madrasa student before him, that class 3 madrasa student will read better than him, but we will accept our deen from him. Because why? It is in accordance with our whims and fancies. We are not so generous in matters of our own physical self, and we are not so generous in matters of our wealth. But deen, because we have cheapened our deen, we don't give it the importance it deserves, therefore we accept everyone. So understand this very properly. To conclude, that understanding the Holy Quran is a right and duty that we owe to the Holy Quran, but proper understanding. There are those ayats which only the meaning only Allah Ta'ala knows. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَعْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. No one knows the meaning of that besides Allah. That we will say, O Allah, we accept that it comes from you and we believe in it. Then there are those ayats of the Holy Quran, moral precepts. Make mention of the Akhirah. Mention is made of Allah Ta'ala's qualities, those in which there are no debates. Those must become etched in our memory. And we must use it as an inspiration and guide to our day-to-day lives. There are many ayats which make mention of moral precepts. You don't need interpretations and tafsirs with regard to that. وَلَا تَقْرَبُوا الزِّنَا. Don't come near adultery. Now what do you need to do? You have to practice upon that. قُلْ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَغُضُّوا مِنْ أَبْصَارِهِمْ. Tell unto the believers that they must cast their gazes down whenever the consideration requires. وَآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَى حَقَّ. Give your relatives the right view. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Be kind to your parents. Those moral precepts, you don't need much debate about it. That must become etched in our memories to serve as an inspiration and guide to our day-to-day lives. And with regard to Allah Ta'ala's Qudrat, إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Verily, in the coming of day and night, and in the changing of the, in the creation of the heavens and earth, there is signs of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. That we can understand, and we must understand it, and it must remain etched in our memories. Then there are the third types of ayats which are ambiguous in meaning, that we should refer it to the ulama and those who have spent their lives in understanding the Holy Quran. May Allah Ta'ala give you the tawfiq of understanding and making amal. It's a very important thing that I have made mention of. We should try and grasp and understand what has been made mention of. The second right that we owe to the Holy Quran is understanding. And what is meant by the understanding is, what the ulama say is, a proper understanding of the Holy Quran. Is there not?